SOS Potter Phase 2. Announce. Episode 1. What the hell? Day 1. Phase 2. June 29, 1996. 1:01 p.m. GMT. Harry asked Dobby to produce a parchment and quill and then dictated a sizzling note. He then made 4 copies for delivery to the Daily Prophet, the Quibbler, and the MNN. Magical News Network, or better known as the Wizard's Wireless News WWN. Which, like many things in the magic world, that name never made any sense to Harry, as only 1 in 200 wizards or witches even knows what the hell a wire actually is. Harry then teleported one of those notes straight onto Kingsley's desk, which read, "To the magical world of the United Kingdom. In care of the Daily Prophet, the Quibbler, the WWN, or more properly named, Magical News Network. The Honorable Kingsley Shacklebolt, British Orr. And Minister of Magic. Or Kingsley Shacklebolt and to the current and most recent Minister of Magic. You will find the self-professed Dark Lord Voldemort, whom the ever-incompetent Fudge prefers to believe does not exist, in a ministry holding cell on level 9. I have devised a method of draining this menacing prick of most
Keep
of his
right,
magic permanently.
And then exit right.
Put the creature that remains on trial for his many crimes and lock the sick bastard in a dark cell, perhaps
exit
with Fudge and Umbridge
right
for company under the influence of Dementors for their punishments. You must, I repeat, you must keep this sick bastard alive for as long as possible. I have found a way to lengthen his lifespan about 30 years or so. Since Tom Marvolo Riddle, otherwise known as Lord Voldemort, is 70 years old this year, and he could normally live to be around 120-130 years old with the help of magic. I have left him with just enough magic to sustain that normal wizard's lifespan. This, in combination with the additional 30 years, gives him the possibility to live up to about 150 years of age in order to serve his sentence before dying of natural causes. I did this because I am an eye for an eye believer, an old Voldemort has been a public menace for at least 30 years. However, be vigilant and watch out for a suicide on his part. I expect he will not take kindly to serving around 80 years in a dark cell with barely enough magic to cast a Lumos spell. Bear this in mind, carefully. He has managed to split his soul into 7 Horcruxes, which I know of. When the thing that remains dies, it is possible Voldemort could resurface a few years after that. Hunt down these Horcruxes and destroy them all! I honestly doubt he will return, at least in any menacing way, as I permanently removed his magic anyway. But don't get complacent. The rest of his demented followers are up to you and the many ministry orders to find and deal with. Start by actually looking for people all around you that bear his dark mark instead of pretending it doesn't exist. Begin with Lucius Malfoy. He is the number one supporter of Voldemort. He also has a dark mark on his left forearm, obvious enough to blind a 60-foot basilisk. And from what I understand, that mark has to be taken willingly. You might also look under the drawing room floor at Malfoy Manor for dark artifacts. He has or had a hidden chamber there. And find Peter Pettigrew Aka Wormtail. He is, in the true sense, a rat, and very much alive. Remove the self-serving, current Minister of Magic. Prosecute particularly Dolores Jane Umbridge for sending 2 Dementors after me at Privet Drive in Surrey 2 summers ago. For using a blood quill on me and other students at Hogwarts when she turned the school upside down with her insane ministry decrees, and for attempting to use an unforgivable curse on me last year. Prosecute Fudge for his approval of her actions and his past corruption and bribes taken from Malfoy and others to look the other way in support of their illegal activities over the past decades. Seek out the witnesses and bring its documentation for all these crimes. The evidence is as plain as the dark mark on Malfoy's arm if you people just look for it. Just clean up your act. If I should ever return here and find this kind of mess, by that I mean this state of corruption and pure blood bigotry that currently exists in this British magical world, I will permanently fix it myself, and you won't like my methods, or I will simply and permanently remove it from existence. That is an absolute promise, no threat intended, and I now have the power and willingness to do just that. I very easily removed Voldemort's magic and can do the same individually or on a very large scale if you don't change the way you people think and act. Your justice system needs full checks and balances to ensure that only the guilty get punished and the innocent go free. Not the other way around, as you people have practiced for generations. so don't push me. You won't like the results. I will no longer be a part of, or tolerate this, magic world's bullshit, corruption and pure blood bigotries. Equalize the status of other sentient, intelligent, magical creatures. All of them. Or I just may put them in charge of you and see how you like persecution when the proverbial shoe is on the other foot. You would do well by electing Hermione Jean Granger as your next Minister of Magic. She is the smartest witch amongst all of you to have surfaced in probably centuries. Use common sense in your thinking and judgment. I have noticed in my 6 years amongst you that only one in every 200 or 300 of you even know what the hell common sense is. Look it up in a Muggle dictionary, for Merlin's sake. Clean up the state of Britain's magical society, or else forfeit altogether. If I come back here at some future time and nothing has changed for the better, I will remove all the magic from witches and wizards and put the magical creatures and other sentient, intelligent species in charge of you all. Or I will just remove all the magic and simply say, the hell with you all. Am I making myself clear and understood, especially to you inbred, bigoted, pure blood supremacist? I repeat. Clean up your act, or else. Don't bother to search for me, I will not be found or seen again unless I deem it necessary or want to be found. You can have a much better life if you all take the steps to some sort of enlightenment. Best of luck to all. I'm out of here. Signed, Harry James, gotta go Potter, Traveler Extreme. Harry chuckled at his quip, Traveler Extreme, then returned the ship to Earth's orbit. Dobby? We have a few more things we still have to do before we venture off on the new adventure, but I want to ask you one more time if you still really want to go with me? Once we leave Earth's orbit it will be too late to change your mind. What do you say, Dobby? Dobby really want to go on adventures with Harry, sir. Dobby learned to function here to help any way Dobby can, sir. As Dobby reiterated his willingness to stay, his head was bobbing up and down, making his ears also flap up and down in an affirmative fashion, while wringing his three-fingered hands in a nervous fashion. We will have to find some way for you to access the computers using those three fingers, I guess. Harry said, while looking at Dobby's hands. And that reminds me, I want to stock up on some human Earth food supplies and modify the nutrition center to either manufacture or at least dispense those foods. I don't think I can stomach the current menu for very long. Harry said as he further mused about modifying that damn toilet as well. We will remain here until we get all of these things working to our satisfaction. Dobby, please make a list so we don't forget anything important. Include on that list a method of private or emergency communication with a couple of our friends here. Harry said as he continued musing about coming to the rescue in an emergency situation. Okay, what's next? Harry mused. Ah yes, I must name this ship as well. Several names ran through Harry's mind, but it was Dobby that came up with just the right name. Would Captain Potter like to call the ship the SOS Potter for the space option ship Potter, Captain? Sir? Dobby said, with a military salute and a wide smile on his face. Harry laughed loudly, then repeated, the SOS Potter, the space option ship Potter. That will do very nicely, indeed Dobby, but I also want to add a new nickname to myself just for laughs and something that I choose, rather than a name thrown on me by others. I will adopt the new nickname for those in the know as Gotta Go Potter. Please make a note for the ship's log, Dobby. Use a parchment until you have learned how to make the necessary entries in the ship's computer logs. Dobby snapped his fingers and quill and parchment appeared in the air in front of him, ready to take automatic dictation. Then, add this to the log, Dobby. Captain Harry James Potter of the SOS Potter, standing for the Space Option Ship Potter. Then add, Commander Dobby? Do you have a second or want a nickname, Dobby? Commander? Sir? Was Dobby's perplexed response. Yes indeed, Dobby, you are my first official crew member and as of this moment, second in charge of the ship. Do you have or want to choose a second or nickname, Dobby? Harry said with a big smile. Well sir then, Commander Fix-It Dobby can be fine, Captain. Sir. As Dobby split a full ear-to-ear grin and saluted again. Harry, laughing once again said, very well then, add Commander Fix-It Dobby as first officer and second in command of the space option ship Potter. You really do have a strange sense of humor, Commander Fixit. And welcome on board, Commander. Musing to himself about these nicknames, for a moment Fixit and Gotago just seemed so surreal. Harry thought. For a moment he imagined a ship to shore, communication with Dobby about some ship's problem preventing a beam up or other such emergency situation and thinking he could be saying, Commander Fixit. Just fix it now, and get me the hell out of here. I gotta go now, it won't keep any longer, and that's an order, Commander Fixit. Just fix it now. Harry can barely control his laughing at this possible, absurd, future situation. Dobby noticed this musing by Harry and asked, Captain. Sir. What does Captain Potter find so very amusing, sir? Can Dobby be having a good laugh too, sir? Harry spun his head around so fast there was an audible snap, and then he just said, Ah well, Commander, it was just some mind musing. You would have had to be there to appreciate it, Dobby. Actually, I was musing about our chosen nicknames and imagining a scenario where I was stuck on a planet with a broken teleport module and was screaming at Commander Fixit to just fix it and get me out of there. That sort of musing, Dobby. Yes, Dobby, can see the humor of that, sir. What do we do next, Captain? Dobby asked, anxious to get to work at something. Well, I think we eventually have to have you access the computer systems and properly interface with them without it nearly killing you, as it nearly did to me. And on that, I think I have a solution to that problem. Although I will have to repeat my earlier access as well, as it was incomplete as I have missing bits of information. But first you need a tour, I think. Harry said. So let us first take a ship's tour, as I did, so you know where to find everything and I can point out some things I didn't know on my first journey through this craft. First, we are on the bridge of this three-deck craft. This is the bridge computer console interface. There are three round doors on this deck that enter this bridge. They are over there, there and that one there. First go over near one of them and see how they operate, Dobby. And Dobby did just that with wide-eyed enthusiasm. As he approached the door, it opened as usual, and Dobby made a mental note of its operation. Dobby, between each door are the transparent viewing walls. These walls have built-in transmitting and receiving sensors, which turn the walls into a sort of window, or maybe a two-way telescreen is a better reference. Straight above the computer console, where you see that large light fixture in the ceiling. That light slides down like a lift in a muggle high-rise building to about 20 centimeters above the console, and a liquid ceramic type of material solidifies into a stairway for access to the airlock and docking port above that ceiling.
Exit.
This is for bridge docking with another ship or craft, and perhaps others similar to this one, I think. It also serves as an upper exit from the ship if we should ever have to land it for any reason. There is a sliding liquid ceramic platform that reaches from the inside of the outer airlock, up there above that light housing.
Keep left, and then turn internal lift. Left.
When the housing or lift ascends again, with a passenger inside it, we then enter the airlock. Then exit the outer airlock hatchway out onto the surface of the craft and either walk or move up and down the side of the craft to the ground level. This liquid ceramic sort of rolls out like a giant tongue, I suppose, and creates a stairway type extension or ramp that can act like an escalator or some similar mechanism. Moving up and down to the ground level is the best way to put it, I guess. There are also 8 telescoping support arms that lower from 8 points under the main deck for full ground support of the ship, again in the event we should ever need to land this craft on solid ground. But, I find it very unlikely we would ever have to actually land this craft as we can hover undetected just above ground level or any other altitude in most situations and teleport in and out of the ship as the need arises. Do you understand all of that so far, Dobby? Yes, sir, Captain. Dobby gets it, sir. Well, there is not much else to tell you about the bridge as yet, so let us investigate the power source next then. I think this just might scare the ears off you, Commander. And Harry left while Dobby grabbed hold of both his ears.
This is where
just before they left the bridge, Harry remembered he was still projecting his usual Hogwarts clothing and turned off the projector field. Dobby jumped a bit, startled by Harry's sudden appearance change, and just squeaked out. Yowzer, sir? What be that green thing Harry is wearing, sir? Ah, that we will get to that a bit later, but it is an environment suit, and I've got one just for you as well. Harry said with an amused twinkle in his eyes. Proceeding through one of the bridge doors and over to the ladders, then descending two levels, they came out on the narrow corridor surrounding the magnetic current anti-gravity field propulsion matrix. Entering the small access chamber and moving over to one of the floor-mounted iris access ports. They both approached as the iris port opened and exposed the chamber once again. They both lowered their heads through the access port, and Mary pointed out the various accoutrements connected to the matrix and explained, to a more detailed degree, how the matrix actually worked. Harry explained that the three long cylinders hanging down were able to move to any position in the chamber by pivoting on several pivot points. He then described in which configuration these cylinders would be in for different flight scenarios. Harry continued, for example, if we are traveling in the saucer configuration through an atmosphere or liquid, these three cylinders would form a wide triangular tripod shape, pointing down, but to the sides, and the entire assembly would rotate according to flight dynamics such as speed, altitude, etc., using the planetary gravity for propulsion, which is all controlled from the bridge. He then went on to explain, if we are traveling in the sublight or hyperspace and also in the subspace and wormhole configurations, we travel in the bridge forward position and these cylinders conform to or modify the space gravity, actually catching and dispersing, or more accurately, a push and pull on that space gravity, also known by Earth science as dark matter, by unidirectional displacements. This allows the ship to travel very, very fast in different configurations. Harry had to stop a moment and catch his breath, then took another deep breath and continued, while Dobby just listened, with ears perked up at full attention. In the terms known to Earth science, sublight speed is any speed under one light speed. In metric units, the speed of light represented by the letter C is exactly 299,792,458 meters per second, or 1,079,252,848 kilometers per hour. In imperial units, the speed of light is about 670,616,629 miles per hour, or 983,571,056 feet per second, which is about 186,282,397 miles per second, or roughly 1 foot per nanosecond. Harry, after inhaling another deep breath, continued with, hyperspace is any speed above light speed up to a factor of 10. There is an effect on time when using this method, but by making certain adjustments while traveling, that effect can mostly be compensated for. Using subspace wormholes allows the ship to essentially bend space to shorten the distance between two points. This is the fastest method of getting from one point in space to another, but is only at its peak efficiency for very, very long distances, and time is not usually affected in the same way hyperspace travel is. Okay, Dobby, do you understand any of that? Dobby is not sure, sir. Dobby is a bit dizzy from the field effect and all those numbers rolling around in my head, but Dobby thinks I understand the general idea, Captain. Sir. Dobby said with a bit of a head shake, sort of both up and down and back and forth at the same time. Harry left a bit at that, and simply said, Dobby, once we hook you up to the computers, this will all seem like child's play, I hope. Was Harry's answer, while his thumb and index finger was rubbing his chin. The bottom of this chamber also acts as a combined solar, electromagnetic current bounce back field matrix. But perhaps equally as important, is capable of generating and firing a magnetic current displacement field to act as a primary weapon. This weapon is capable of great destruction if used in that manner or if the need ever arises. Those numerous bounce back collector nodes on the bottom of the magnetic current converters and field discharge spheres can funnel magnetic current energy to eight external firing ports on the outer hull surrounding the ship and dispersing or firing like that of a handheld three-phase digger weapon like this one, as Harry showed Dobby one of the flashlight-like digger weapons attached to his utility belt, which Harry had renamed from the alien's word for it, which was Pinka, which originally got its name from the disintegrator setting, which was often used to dig through rocks and other very hard materials. Harry said while taking another deep breath, that's all I need to show you now. You will better understand all of this once the computers have integrated this information directly into your brain, okay, Commander? Harry asked again. Yes, sir, Captain. Dobby gets it. It's not nearly as bad as Yaus made it out to be, sir.
And then exit right.
Dobby said while shaking and rolling his head a bit with a huge smile while checking to be sure his ears were still attached.
Exit right.
Oh, wait until you see the toilets. You get to be the first to try one out, Dobby. Harry said with a cheeky grin hidden inside a smirk. Proceeding out of this power plant and ascending the ladder once again, coming out on the main deck just outside the nutrition and recycling rooms. Harry decided to start where he had started in his first unofficial tour and backtrack down the corridor to the medical bay and entered it first. This is where I first arrived in this place, Dobby. I was abducted very early this morning by those three aliens lying there on the floor. I was secured to that examination table, I guess, assumed by these aliens to be unconscious, and in my panic state of mind, my magic went wild and inadvertently killed these three creatures. I then staggered around a bit, looking this place over and making some observations about them. I suppose it is time to remove these aliens before they start to stink up the place, Harry stated in a matter-of-fact tone. Harry then took out one of his digger weapons and set the rotating cylinder at the front end to the third or disintegrator setting and pointed it at one of these aliens. Pushing the trigger button, he watched as the disintegrator beam struck one of the aliens and was momentarily mesmerized as the alien slowly shimmered a bit and disappeared into nothingness. He repeated this action on the other two of them, to the same result. After they had disappeared, Harry made note of the fact that there was no trace that they had ever been there, not even a residual matter trace left on the floor. Unwell, complete disintegration then. Harry mused out loud.
I'll find a new
wowzer, that's some new kind of wand, Harry. Is that the digger weapon you showed me a bit ago? Dobby squeaked out. Yes indeed it is, Commander. We will get to that when we see the tool room. That's also the room you will find your new environment suit, although I wonder if we will have to manufacture a special one for you to fit properly into.
Finding a new route.
Although I suppose not, since these suits seem to fit those smaller aliens
turn
just
left.
Fine, and I had no problem with it conforming to fit me as well. Dobby, can I ask you a personal question, since I have no real idea of how an elf does this? Yes sir, Harry, ask away. Dobby beamed at Harry, thinking he knew just what Harry was going to ask him. How do you go to the toilet? Is it much the same as we do it, or is there some magic method you use or whatever? Harry's face turned a bit red at the question he was asking, but he stood his ground anyway. Dobby actually smiled, then said, "Well, Captain, we has much the same kind of equipment that yous do, sir, just a bit
keep
smaller
left,
and male elves,
and
their bits tucked inside," Dobby stated. Harry smiled and said, Good, Dobby. I can't wait to see your reaction to putting the suit
turn
on for the
left.
First time. It was quite an experience for me, I tell you." Harry once again turned as red as a tomato at the remembered incident. Okay, onward then. This is the medical bay, obviously. Over there are the main medical computers, with a vast knowledge base that these aliens have collected from all over the galaxy and Merlin knows
keep
wherever
right.
else.
And then turn
that
right.
seems to be pretty much all I can say about this room, so let us move on to the nutrition room then.
Turn
Harry
right.
chewed his bottom lip as they approached this room, remembering it seemed so very empty on his last inspection of it. Entering once again, he walked over to the dispensing computer, and this time he could read the symbols on the wall above the console. Although he could read them now, they
left.
Made little more sense to him now than they did before, as he had no reference point to compare them with Earth foods. Pointing at one of the symbols, he said,
"Turn left,
and this one says,
and then
eagles,
turn right.
Whatever that means. And this one says, whippets." From his earlier experience,
turn
the
right.
only one he could make sense of was the water, whose symbol said, tappen. Okay, Dobby, the only one I can translate is the one for water, that is the symbol for water, and the word, it sounds to me like, tappen. Press that button and see what will happen, Dobby. Dobby pressed it, and again, nothing happened. Okay. Harry said, "I wanted to see if you got the same response from it that I did my first try." Harry then pressed his human finger on the symbol, and a few seconds later a container of water once again appeared, not having to transfigure his hand this time. Then Harry pressed the symbol for the horrible tasting purple one and asked Dobby to taste it and give his opinion on what he thought. Dobby made a face at it after he tasted it and said, "Dobby thinks it tastes like gravel and dirty oil, sir." Okay, that was pretty much what I thought as well, Dobby. Okay, let's try this one then. And Harry pressed the symbol for the orange one and asked Dobby to repeat the taste test. A bit more reluctant now, but Dobby took the plunge anyway. After all, it was a captain's order. Oh, much better, sir. Sort of burnt toast with apple and some pepper, Dobby thinks, sir. Okay, again, pretty much what I thought also. But perhaps you can transfigure it to something more palatable for both of us. Give it a try, Dobby. Then Dobby's magic went to work on it and transfigured it into a nice-looking chocolate cake. They both had a taste of that and were quite happy that it had worked. Since neither of them had anything to eat for some time, they decided to sit at one of the tables, pulling one of the chairs over to that table and proceeded to devour that chocolate cake. With a mouthful and scarfing it down while simultaneously trying to eat and talk at the same time, Harry tried a little too hard to say,
"Turn
left, I really made that and then turn right. You guard toads me up." After he had managed to swallow that last mouthful, Harry said, "Ah, thank you, Commander, that was really good, and did I ever need that?
Turn
You're very
right.
welcome, Captain Potter, sir." Dottie reiterated the formal jargon as well. "Well, I think this room needs a little more investigating. I was concerned that this room seemed too large and empty for just three aliens to sit back to back while consuming their nutrition."
"Keep right,
Harry
and
said.
Then turn right."
Harry got up and walked around the room a couple of times, looking at the walls and floor in particular and trying to remember
turn
if the
right.
download of information had imparted any info on this room, and decided it was a part of some still missing info that didn't make the trip in the first download interface he had nearly killed himself with. He went over to the right side wall and moved the table out into the middle of the room and felt along the wall for some hidden panel, switches, buttons or something, but found nothing useful along the walls. But below him on the floor was a hidden indentation. "Ah, there is something here," he said out to Dottie, who was doing much the same
Keep
on the
right.
other side of the room. Harry pushed a bit on a part of the floor where this indentation was, when a part of the floor slid back into the inside and under the floor, exposing what Harry thought was some sort of cooking machine that popped up on a scissors-like assembly from under the floor and looked sort of like a microwave oven. Harry, figuring it was probably not a microwave but more likely a magnetic current cooking device. It seemed to Harry that everything about this craft was based on this electric and magnetic current combined technology. Harry had heard the term magnetic current somewhere before but still had not been able to put his proverbial finger on just where he had heard or read about this. But it was certainly like nothing any Earth technology was capable of, currently, so to speak. Pardon the pun, he thought to himself as he chuckled a bit at his quip again. It had a compartment like that of a regular oven about 1 meter square inside. Big enough to cook about 7 good-sized turkeys in it, Harry thought, and assuming it was a cooking device. He needed to get back into that computer chair and get the rest of the download info soon, rather than stumbling around, guessing at what things were for, and potentially making a huge mistake, blowing both of them up in a state of ignorant, bumbling about. "Okay, Commander, look for more of these indentations on the floor and open any you find, and we will try and figure out what they do." So Dottie did just that, finding several more of these, and out popped three more box-type devices that Harry had actually recognized what they were, as this info had made the trip in the first download. "Dottie, can you guess what these three devices are?" he asked with a big smile to show for his understanding of these. "My first best guess would be some sort of coffin, sir, but it seems a strange place for coffins. Apart from that, I has not a clue, sir." "Ah, my friend Dottie, it is the answer to our food problem, and on a very long time scale as well," Harry answered with a knowing smirk embedded behind a stifled smile. "You, how's that, sir?" "Well, Dottie, these are stasis chambers, no doubt using a form of magnetic current frequency folding stasis field technology. I recognize what they are but don't yet know exactly how they work. Only that inside these chambers there is a quantum probability of zero, that is, no passage of time, that is, time stands still, for whatever is inside these chambers, that is, movement through time, does not exist, therefore a quantum probability of zero exists inside these chambers, while time for us outside these stasis chambers resumes at its normal pace. Did you get that, Dottie?" "Sir, could Yaus not have just said they was freezers instead of the double
keep
talk?"
Left.
"If Yaus keep doing that to Dottie, sir, Dottie be giving Captain Potter a tail or worse,
sir." Dottie smirked out.
"Well, okay, Dottie, no tail, please. I promise I will be good."
Harry backed away with both hands up in a defensive posture, while both of them smiling at the thought of Dottie giving his captain a tail for being cheeky to his commander and thinking that would be one of those fixes Dottie would be getting famous for, all right. "Well, shall we move on then, Commander?" Harry asked, now holding both hands over his buttocks, afraid Dottie might just throw a tail on him when his back was turned.
"Keep left.
After you, sir," Dottie said with a cheeky smirk, trying to double as a serious look. "Okay, Dottie, you first, and just make a left in the corridor and enter the next room, just down there, okay?" Harry was still protecting his delicate backside, not entirely sure he could turn his back on the elf now. Dobby just huffed as he made his way out of the nutrition room and left down the corridor to the recycling and processing room. Entering, he stepped aside and just waited for Captain Potter to work up the nerve to follow him. As Harry entered, he said, just out to tail who you consider okay, without too much double talk. I really don't want to tail Dobby, but I really don't know how to make this not seem like what you call double talk. Oh come on, Captain, does Yaus really think that Commander Fix-It Dobby would give his captain a tail? Sir? In a word. Yes. Harry smiling, but a defensive smile nonetheless. Dobby just smirked at him and gestured with his three-fingered hand for Harry to continue the tour. Okay then, this is the processing and recycling room, and it is also for manufacturing anything we might need, like replacement digger weapons, environment suits, or just about anything else we can input a matrix to the computer for it to manufacture. Those two units on the far wall, the green and blue ones, with a control and the receptor plate on it, are for fine adjustments, and the left one is for the manufactured item to materialize using a combination of matter enhancement and teleportation, or more simply put, materializing the product through matter transmutation and teleportation technology. Then Harry backed up a pace or two, with both hands on his bum again. Captain, what would be making you think that a tail must always be in the place you is protecting yourself, sir? Dobby said, trying really hard not to break out laughing at his captain's whitening face. Okay, you have had your bit of fun at my expense, now I'm putting a stop to it. That is an order, Commander Fix-It Dobby. I can't go around protecting strange parts of my body all the time worrying about you throwing a tail on me in some strange place, okay, Commander? Harry said in his best, stern captain's demeanor. Are you is no fun at all, Captain? Sir. But Commander Dobby promise not to put a tail on Captain Potter unless Yaus really, really deserves it, sir.
Keep left.
Is that mate Yaus feels better, sir? Dobby said, standing at full attention while saluting again. But I guess it will just have to do then. Harry said, removing his protecting hands, and continued the dialogue tour of the recycling parts of this room. The three right units are for recycling ship's waste products like disposed of foods and crew waste from toilet and sonic showers, dust, bodily oils, etc. The three left units are for air and water recycling and processing. All of these products go through an extensive magnetic cleaning, refining, and purifying process that the end product is as pure as it could possibly get. I know it sounds a bit disgusting in a way, but the processing is so clean, in the end it is purer and less harmful than any natural foods or water you could find on Earth. Harry took another deep breath and continued. I noticed when we were in the food room that the water container and the other two containers that I had produced earlier for taste testing were gone when we entered the room. That is because the ship's internal sensors detected, after a time, that it was an organic waste product and recycled the whole thing, including the containers, which are a byproduct of the recycling process and also organic in nature. It's very efficient actually, and no dishes to do or after meal cleanups, etc. You just leave it there, and a short time later the ship removes the waste by internal teleportation, straight into the recycling processors.
Keep right,
and
then
Harry
turn
needed
right.
Another deep breath. Okay, on to the crew quarters now. Harry said, while trying
turn
to hold
right.
back his internal smirk and maintain a professional captain's demeanor. Entering the first crew quarters, Harry pointed out the anti-gravity sleeping regeneration chamber in its vertical positioning. Okay, Commander, give that a try. There is a button on the inside to open the sliding door when you are ready to exit. The chamber removes the gravity after the door is closed, so don't be alarmed by the feeling of weightlessness. Harry reiterated for Dobby's benefit. Dobby entered and closed the door and could be heard saying, "Wowie, sir, Dobby be enjoying this place, sir. Okay, Dobby, come on out now. But Dobby be having too much fun in here, sir. Can Dobby be staying in here a little longer, sir?" "Plenty of time for that later, Commander. Come on now, check this out," Harry said with a cheeky smile. Dobby reluctantly exited the chamber and stumbled a bit over to the other sliding door in the far corner. This is the crew toilet facility. Waste is removed in the same way the food and other waste is removed. After we deposit our body's waste in that, it is automatically removed after a time. Give it a try, Dobby. I will wait over here for you. Yes, sir, Captain. Sir. Dobby been needing to go for some time now. When Dobby entered the toilet, the transparent enclosure turned opaque and Harry could not see through the enclosure anymore, but he could hear Dobby plain enough. He was making a sound like he was riding a bucking bronco horse. Wee-ee-owser-wee-ee-pee-ee-owser-wee-ee-pee-ee-owser. After a few minutes, Dobby exited the toilet with a spin and just a bit dizzy, saying,
"Captain,
sir, yous really gots to try that, sir. It's be one of the wildest rides I's ever be on, sir. Great fun, sir." Harry just had a seriously perplexed look on his face at how Dobby seems to think it was some sort of fairground ride. Harry just shook his head in utter amazement at this elf's flexibility to adjust to the strangest and most unusual situations. "Well, Dobby, that was fun for you, was it?"
"Oh, yes, sire, sir. Great fun, Captain.
Sir, has not tried that yet?"
"No, Commander, I have been avoiding that thing. It scares the goosebumps right off my arms.
Anyway, we need to move on now. The next two rooms are the same as this one, and you can have this room as your quarters if you want, Dobby."
"Mine will be the third one, and for now we will leave the middle one as a reserve or spare, for the time being anyway,"
Harry said.
"Oh, yesiree, Captain.
Sir, I will be very happy to have in that room as Dobby's very own playing room."
"Thank you, Captain.
Sir,"
Dobby said, all excited again.
Harry just shook his head again and proceeded down the corridor past the other two crew quarters and pointed out to Dobby which door was the entrance to his quarters. Entering the tool room, Harry once again began to smirk at the thought that Dobby might not find the environment suit quite as much fun. Then, on the other hand, who knows with his elf what he may make of it, or what the hell might happen when he tries it on? Harry mused again to himself. They approached the end table where the digger weapons and the utility belts were. This time Harry started with the environment suit, explaining its function on waste removal and recycling, and the protection this suit had to offer against a number of dangers, and suggested he needed to put it on and that he would wear it at all or most of the time from now on. He pointed out the environment, pressure and magnetic current shielding controls on the utility belt and told Dobby that they worked together with a suit, and he could work in a vacuum or in the power chamber if needed, that the suit itself would deflect magnetic energy around him so as to not affect him like it did earlier when they were in the power chamber. He stood back, trying to maintain that captain's professional demeanor again while Dobby put this suit on. Dobby slipped this suit on as though he was born to it, without any reaction the likes of which Harry had experienced, and poor Harry was just not having any fun with this. Now, since we know that Dobby is something of a mind reader when it comes to Harry and is unknown to Harry, bond with him, Dobby decided to have a bit of fun at Harry's expense again. A few seconds after Dobby had the suit on, he started to vibrate and fell to the floor, holding his bits and rolling about the floor, making more of those squeaking sounds he had earlier in the toilet, like he was on a great fairground ride. He kept this up until Harry could not hold back his laughter and was equally on the floor, holding his sides from splitting from his surprised and out of control laughter. Then Dobby just stood up calm as could be and said, while pointing at Harry, "What's you laughing at? You think this is funny, doss you?" And then threw that magic tail on Harry in the most stern demeanor Dobby could manage. Then stood there with his little arms crossed and an equally cross look on his face. "Yikes, jeebies, crikers, get this thing off me, Dobby. I'm sorry I laughed at you, but I just couldn't help myself."
"That's an order, fix it now, Dobby. Ouch, that thing hurts."
Harry, not laughing anymore and hopping around trying not to step on his new tail, which was snaked down the inside of his left leg, coming out the bottom and stretching the environment suit to accommodate the new tail, then extending about 1 meter on the floor.
"Say it again, you is sorry."
Still holding that stern and rather cross look on his face.
"Yes, jeebies, yes, I'm sorry, Dobby. Please, fix it, Dobby, now, please."
Harry managed to scream out. Then Dobby, having had his fun, removed the tail and fell to the floor laughing, the likes of which Harry had never seen or would have believed an elf could laugh or carry on. Harry just sat there catching his breath and looking very perplexed at this elf, wondering just what the hell he had gotten himself into. Then Dobby, having finished with his laughing little prank on his captain, stood and pointed at Harry and simply said,
"That's will teach yous not to try and pull ones over on this elf, Captain, sir."
And left again, then said, "Dobby has a bond with Harry Potter and can, to some degrees, read your thoughts, sir. I just had to get even with yous for trying to get ones over on Dobby several times today already. And Dobby, promise he would not give yous a tail unless yous deserve it, sir." and Dobby thinks yous deserve it that time, sir. Is Dobby be forgiven, sir? Bloody hell, Dobby, you sure know how to prank me. But I as Captain Harry James Potter forbid you from ever, I mean ever, giving me a tail again, no matter what. Crackers, or it will be 30 days in the Brigadier for you. That was not a fun experience at all, Dobby, but, as you have said a few times today, I gets it, sir. Then smile down at his little frightening friend. Then Harry asked him, that business in the toilet, you were having me on that time too, weren't you, Dobby? Yes, sir, I was having you on, sir. But yous really do have to try that thing, sir. It is not as bad as yous think, and I promise it will not eat you, sir. And does we have a Brigadier, sir? Dobby said with a big, rather suspicious smile on that innocent-looking face. I'll make one if I have to, Commander. Harry said with an equally innocent smile. No, sir. That will not be necessary, Captain. Sir. Was Dobby's equally innocent response. Okay, Dobby, this is the last room, the information and mapping room, which does many other things as well. This is where you will interface with the computers for the brain download of the ship's functions, etc. But first I need to make some adjustments, take in some missing information and maybe alter the way this computer operates. Just hang in over there for a bit, Dobby, while I work with this. Harry said and went to sit in that comfy computer chair again. Harry placed his hands on the interface and began his manipulations. First he needed to complete the download he was ejected from earlier. When he was satisfied he had been properly downloaded to, he placed a lockout on the system so an accident like he had could not happen again. The interface would just go nerd if someone unauthorized attempted a download like that.
Exit.
He then configured the computer to download in a slower fashion for Dobby. It was then that he realized he could reprogram some of the ship's systems to accommodate a more human-like crew, and the very first thing he did was reprogram his captain's quarters for two things: to alter the structure of the toilet and to manufacture a standard sectional couch and office desk for his quarters to give the place a more human touch and accessibility. He didn't want to be confined to that sleeping chamber all the time and knew he would be more comfortable with a homier feel. He told Dobby to sit down in the chair and take in his download of ship's information, and that it would take some time to complete as he slowed it down so the system would not hurt him. He had Dobby transfigure one of his hands to what looked like the alien's hand, and then placed it on one of the pads, and then Harry placed one of his hands on the other pad and the download began. At the same time Harry nudged Dobby over a bit and sat beside him in the computer chair, then the chair widened to accommodate the new size and mess. After around 15 minutes, Dobby's download was complete and he now had the same information and understanding of the ship and a new outlook on the universe. Harry just watched Dobby for a few minutes, worried it may have harmed him. As he watched Dobby's face, it seemed to change with a form of enlightenment. Dobby turned to look at Harry with big blue and much brighter eyes and said, Harry, are you aware that using the hyperspace protocols and adjusting the negative magnetic flux and associated tangibility equations, we are able to travel backwards in time? By the same method, adjusting the positive magnetic flux and associated equations, we are also able to move forward in time. There are restrictions on the magnetic flux matrix adjustments on the order of 10 to the 42nd power, but it is still possible. That won't allow us to be pinpoint accurate to an exact date, but we can arrive with a margin of approximately between 5 and 30 Earth days to a planned destination in time, either way, sir. As Dobby was informing Harry of the hyperspace theory of time travel, Harry was formatting that same information in his mind and said, Yes, Commander, as you were informing me of that information, it also came to the front of my thoughts as well. Then Harry continued saying, It is also theoretically possible using the slingshot type of effect around the singularity, or by operating at a speed of 1/1 light speed or higher or 1 above light speed, using hyperspace by orbiting the Earth, in this case, and for a negative time jump, in the reverse rotation of the planet, with one rotation subtracting one Earth day and vice versa, in the positive or same rotation of the planet. This theory and principle can apply to any planet, system, star, or singularity like black or white holes. There is a similar theoretical principle for using dark matter to achieve the same effect, but I have no intention of jumping about in time unless it is an emergency of some kind. Then Harry took another deep breath and they both fell to the floor laughing at each other's new understanding of the universe and of the ship's capabilities. After collecting themselves, Harry looked at the new and improved Dobby and said, I think that download really tuned us both up a lot, eh Dobby? Oh yes sir, I feel like a whole new person, I'm stronger in my magic as well as my mind, Captain, Dobby said with no more chopped up or mangled language speaking difficulties, then continued. I understand the ship's functions now, and everything you explained to me earlier, as well as a few things you didn't mention. I also have an idea for a portable communications earpiece that we will need, and I know you want to have one or two contacts on Earth for emergency communications as well. Am I right in thinking you are having Fred and George in mind as those planet side contacts, Captain? Yes indeed, I think they are the best for this as they are located right in the heart of the magic community and have eyes and ears to just about anything that could happen down there. Get started on the earpiece, comm links, and for the twins, I think two medallions like a galleon with a press to record a message and send button on one in red for Fred and one in blue for George. They must be made to explode if tampered with and to disintegrate if outside a 2 meter distance from their owners. They won't tamper with or try to take them apart if they know it will explode, eliminating anything within a 20 meter circumference, and they won't let them out of their sight or for that matter away from around their necks if they know they will lose them by disintegration if they get careless. Harry stated. Then Dobby asked, Harry, are you going to tell them about the ship? No way, as far as anyone on Earth needs to know is that I am just traveling in sight, seeing which will be the truth, just not the whole truth, and make Fred and George's galleon-type medallions strictly record a message, then send and receive a message from me. I don't think we need to have direct, real-time voice links with anyone but ship's crew, and right now that is just the two of us. Also, under no circumstances is anyone allowed on this ship without my direct authorization, or is anyone to know anything about this ship, and the ship is to remain in full, shielded stealth mode at all times. Those are full standing, Captain's orders. Harry said in a matter of fact, Captain's demeanor. Aye, Captain Potter, I'll get started on all four units right away, sir. Dobby then worked the computer with both his hands and programmed the two comm links for him and Harry, then programmed the computer to manufacture all four items. After he finished that task, they both went to the recycling manufacturing facility and collected the units. Dobby explained that Harry's operated by tapping the earpiece once to activate the two-way or duplex voice feature, and that he only needed to tap it a second time to deactivate the transmitter and it would stay in the receive mode full time. Dobby's had a slightly different shape but generally operated in the same way. Then they tested the units and were satisfied with them. Dobby went on to explain how they actually worked by transmitting a vibration through the jawbone, and the comm unit earpiece translated that vibration into voice. He then stated that the distance was on the order of about 1 million kilometers. He stated it was basically a ship-to-shore comm link, assuming the ship maintained a standard 1,000-kilometer orbit, and that the extra distance was just a large margin for error factor, big enough to transmit and receive if they were nearly 3 to 4 times the distance as the Earth to the Moon was.
And then
Harry made a flippant comment about how that was a rather large margin for error. Dobby just said, it's always better to be safe than sorry. I can, if you prefer, Harry, increase that distance up to a factor of 10 squared and still maintain efficiency as the crew comm links use the hyperspace communication channels, sir. And Dobby produced a cheeky grin. The units for Fred and George have a much longer range. They use the very, very long-range dynamic magnetic current, multi-subdimensional pulse communication channels to transmit and receive recorded messages, sir. Thank you, Dobby. I think they will be just fine, as is. Harry shook his head at the new improved Dobby, then thought of something else they had yet to try, and asked, Dobby, you have not tried popping within the ship yet, that I know of, so give it a try and see if you can get around in here using your unique popping ability. And Dobby disappeared with no audible crack this time and popped back in a few seconds later with a big smile, saying, I can pop around anywhere in the ship, sir, and I notice that I don't even make the usual accompanied noise. I wonder if it has to do with the internal ship's atmosphere or perhaps the environment suit preventing the air displacement usually associated with elf popping. Among it is probably the environment suits, as they displace the atmosphere around the suit as a byproduct of the waste recycling system and the built-in protection of the suit. All the better to pop silently anyway, as that damn crack always makes me jump. Harry laughed. Okay, Dobby, if we are ready to go and see Fred and George, we should get started and bring those additional 3 notes. I let Fred and George deliver those to the Prophet, Whittler and the W. And this evening. I expect, in a few hours, the news that old Volpe has been neutralized will hit the magical world, and I would expect one hell of a party to start up. Oh yes, and make some adjustments to your holographic projector unit to assume a human size and shape about my size and age. Just make yourself look a bit different. I'll introduce you as a new friend, how about Neil Petatrons? Does that sound okay to you? After all, every good data needs a bit part to play. Harry stated most sincerely. Oh, that sounds just fine to me, but Harry, what's a data anyway? Dobby asked a bit perplexed. Harry's answer was just to say that he was Alpha on the ship and Dobby was Beta, based on the Greek alphabet or first and second in order of rank, but that Beta could be spelled two different ways, with two different meanings, but they sounded the same, and not to worry about it. Oh, I see, sir. Dobby said, but really didn't get the inside joke and figured Harry was trying to put one over on him again and was thinking about what to do to him next, as he was forbidden to give his captain another tale or suffer 30 days in the yet-to-be-built brigadier that he had been threatened with earlier. Then Dobby mused about giving his captain some oversized duck's feet, but let it go for now anyway and just marked it up until Harry totaled up more points before he received another punishment for his cheeky attempts at having his commander on again. End of phase 2.